I just want to, at this point, thank these people for certainly their patience. I mean, could it have dragged on a little longer?
For the first time in human history, geologists are confident that they understand the 500 million years of lunar geologic events since the creation of the near-side volcanic plain known as Mare Imbrium. Two landings on lunar Maria, 11 and 12. One landing in the Imbrium ejecta blanket, an isolated system of highlands called Framorum on 14, and one landing on the geologic border of the Mare Imbrium, a valley in the mountains, Hadley Apennine, on Apollo 15. However, there is still an entire geologic region on the near side left untapped, a place thought to be wholly independent from the influence of the Imbrium formation, or, for that matter, any of the near side lunar Maria. A place that more closely resembles the elusive lunar far side than it does any of its neighbors on the lunar near side. A region also thought to be much, much older. It is the blindingly bright central lunar highlands. Dominating the southern face of the near side of the moon, this area is completely unique when contrasted with the previous Apollo landing sites. Reaching it successfully will fall on the shoulders of yet another ambitious crew of three. An untried rookie lunar module pilot making his first trip into space. A vindicated command module pilot who has been waiting anxiously for his first flight ever since he was taken off the roster of Apollo 13 on the eve of its launch 2 years earlier. And a veteran commander, NASA's most experienced and flight-tested astronaut. A man who is making not his first, but his second trip to the moon. The mission of Apollo 16, set to launch in the spring of 1972, promises to be one of the most incredible missions ever undertaken. An extended scientific expedition, the staggering ambition of which is matched only by the incredible operational experience of NASA personnel. Saturn V, serial AS-511, with command and service module number 113 and lunar module number 11, respectively nicknamed Casper and Orion. The stage is now set for Apollo's penultimate adventure.
Excitement about the space program has cooled. The questions have increased as to why we keep sending men back to the moon at $450 million a trip.
The president gave the go-ahead on a $5.5 billion program to develop a space shuttle.
The president launched the program to develop a space shuttle.
NASA's administrator, Dr. James Fletcher, flew out to California to explain the new space shuttle system to President Nixon. In a statement announcing his decision to go ahead with the system, the president said it will revolutionize transportation into near space by routinizing it.
NASA said tonight the Apollo 16 moon mission, scheduled to lift off on March 17th, has been postponed until the middle of April because of technical problems.
Postponement of the Apollo 16 mission until April 16th. The launch had been scheduled for March 17th.
A technical difficulty in the Apollo 16 rocket may delay its launching date from March until mid-April.
The Apollo program was now no longer about operational feats by this point. The gears had shifted, and the massive exploration machine was now fully committed to scientific investigation. With respect to 16's chosen landing site, it seemed to many to be a can-you-top-this contest of selecting sites that were increasingly more rugged and desolate, with the confident and ambitious astronaut crews cheering them on. However, looming over the program like an impending ghost of death was the knowledge that there would be only one more flight to the moon after this. There would be no more hiring, no new promotions. The golden age of seemingly infinite budgets and limitless future potential was coming to an end, and fast. Massive personnel layoffs were on the horizon. By this point, the Saturn V rocket stage production lines across the country had been shut down. The world was moving on.
By now, a familiar sight. The Saturn V rocket poised on the launch pad to send another team of Apollo astronauts to the moon. This is to be a 12-day mission to the moon's central highlands, man's first close-up look at a type of terrain that covers more than three-fourths of the moon's surface. But pictures of the area have been sparse. They show nothing smaller than 40 feet across. There could be some good-sized boulders and craters there for the astronauts to dodge.
Veteran astronaut John Young, having flown on Gemini 3, Gemini 9, and Apollo 10, is bringing along Lunar Module pilot Charles Duke and Command Module pilot Thomas Kenneth Mattingly on Apollo's second so-called J mission. Two spacecraft, an ALSEP, a lunar rover, and consumables enough to support 3 full days on the lunar surface. Apollo 16 will provide insight to yet another incredible, exotic, and untouched corner of the lunar surface. In the end, it came down to just 2 options. Alphonsus Crater in the western central highlands, and a site just to the west of Mare Nectaris, north of a crater called Descartes. The latter was chosen. The scientific objectives of Apollo 16 will be to sample lunar regolith in an area of plains called Cayley. From the density of the impact craters on the surface, pre-mission geologic studies suggested that the Descartes and Cayley geologic formations combined covered some 11% of the lunar near side, making them important for the overall understanding of the moon's history. The specific landing site is selected between 2 young, fresh impact craters called North Ray and South Ray. Proximity to these craters provides natural drill holes through the regolith at the site, exposing samples of the underlying bedrock in ejecta fragments for sampling.
And a lot of people say, well, it's just what's another bag of rocks. Well, it's just not another bag of rocks. It's a bag of rocks that tells a total history of the evolution of our solar system. And to me, that's a stupefying thought, that you can go up and pick up rocks that are as they were and in the original form, many of them, over 3 to 4 billion years ago. Now that's a long time. And if we can understand through the study of the moon, understand the early processes that went on in the dynamic processes that developed our solar system and our Earth, then I think we'll have a better understanding of the planet on which we live, and we'll be able to plan better for the future and exploration of minerals and things like that.
The lunar maria are effusive eruptions of dark basalt, rich in mafic silicates that yield a low viscosity or highly runny lava that spread out far and wide to form gigantic, smooth plains. By comparison, the central highlands are thought to be sufficiently enriched with silica so as to make its lava much thicker, and after slowly oozing from fissures in the ancient lunar surface, it settled as isolated patches in low-lying areas. Geologists are aiming for Descartes precisely because they believe it is a site rich in formations caused by endogenic processes. They are hunting, like on Apollo 15, for evidence of lunar volcanism. It is a rugged and dangerous area to try and land. And on missions past, the flight dynamics team may have been reluctant or unable to try for such a site. But this was Apollo 16. With 4 prior landings under their belt, NASA believes it is experienced enough to reach yet another step higher. Also, like Apollo 15, 16's site will allow the astronauts to traverse multiple overlapping geologic formations, Cayley to the north and Descartes to the south. John Young and Charlie Duke undergo the same intensive crash course familiarization with the science of geology and petrology as Scott and Irwin did for Apollo 15. Like before, the two will emplace a battery of scientific instruments called an ALSEP, and will explore their landing site with the aid of a battery-powered car called the Lunar Rover.
Well, it was a fun job, and John and I were like two brothers, and we had trained for 2 years in these procedures, and he had a great sense of humor, so we were always joking back and forth in our training. So we decided that we would be serious and do our job, but we were going to have fun doing it. We carried on with that attitude of joking to one another and just having fun. And it was fun, no question about it. And it was wonderful, wondrous. You had this reverence about it almost. And yet you felt the excitement, the awe, the beauty, all of those feelings were in within. But you were having fun doing it. And so John had some crazy jokes, if you will. Not really jokes, but funny things that we talked about and as we did our exercises and experiments.
Orbital science will also be conducted, primarily by the command module pilot, Ken Mattingly. Like his predecessor, Mattingly will operate scientific instruments located outside the spacecraft in the service module, in a section called the Scientific Instrument Module, or SIM Bay. This includes two massive camera systems, the mapping camera and the panoramic camera. The mapping camera is itself comprised of two cameras, one for mapping the stars to determine the exact spacecraft position over the moon, and one for mapping the lunar surface below. These two cameras, called Stellar and Metric, take photographs simultaneously and are used in conjunction with a laser altimeter to produce highly detailed maps of the lunar surface as the command and service module spacecraft orbits above over the course of several days. The Fairchild-built lunar mapping camera shoots on monstrously large 5-inch wide film. The panoramic camera also uses this unusual extreme resolution format that is also used in U-2 and SR-71 spy planes. Both cameras, and the 35mm stellar mapping camera, dump their film into large external magazines that will have to be retrieved by Ken Mattingly via spacewalk when the ship is on its way back to Earth. Other experiments in the SIM Bay includes S-band transponder gravity field mapping, X-ray fluorescence, gamma ray spectrometers, alpha particle spectrometers, orbital mass spectrometers, and bistatic radar scattering. Like on 15, 16 CSM will deploy a small sub-satellite into lunar orbit and leave it there. The mapping cameras alone will be able to return some 5,000 images of the lunar surface. Also, as on previous flights, several small experiments will be flown inside the spacecraft to be operated directly by the astronauts, including window meteoroid impact measurements, a biological experiment to study the effects of cosmic radiation on such things as bacteria spores, seeds, and shrimp eggs, a basic, rudimentary electrophoresis experiment to study the separation of organic molecules in an electric field in zero-g, and finally, a test to study light flashes observed by humans in space, thought to be caused by cosmic rays. The exact mechanism is still not fully understood, even today. Scientists are still uncertain whether it is due to ray particles directly striking the optic nerve, directly striking visual centers in the brain, retinal receptor stimulation, or perhaps even Cherenkov radiation created as the rays pass through the vitreous material of the eyeball itself. The long and still as of yet incomplete field of study regarding this phenomenon we'll start with the flight of Apollo 16. Apollo 16 will also be subjected to some external experimentation as well. The Department of Defense, which has nothing to do with the actual flight, will be performing classified tests of their own, largely in the form of tracking the launch vehicle and spacecraft using over-the-horizon radar systems, which will contribute to the development of missile tracking technology. The flight of Apollo 16 will be visually documented by an inventory of handheld cameras that will be operated by the astronauts. Three kinds of handheld film cameras are being flown. A 16mm variable frame rate film camera developed by Maurer will capture more moving frames of the lunar rover than ever before. It can shoot at 1, 6, 12, or 24 frames per second. Film for each mission is supplied in preloaded film magazines that can be easily installed and/or removed from the camera by an astronaut wearing an EVA suit. Magazine capacity is 130 feet, or 40 meters of thin base film. The total weight of a magazine is approximately 1 pound, just under half a kilogram. Magazine runtime depends on the frame rate. 87 minutes at 1 frame per second to 3.6 minutes at 24 frames per second. Each magazine has a film remaining indicator, plus an end of film red indicator light. The astronauts of Apollo 16 will primarily use the so-called Data Acquisition Camera, or DAC, to document the lunar surface from their rover as they drive across many kilometers of rugged, highland terrain. A second kind of camera being flown is a Nikon F35mm. This is known as a single-lens reflex camera, or SLR, and unlike the other kinds of film cameras, permits the user to view through the lens and see exactly what will be captured. It is to be used for dim light photography of stellar objects, such as the Gegenschein, the Gum Nebula, and the Milky Way. Finally, the third and most utilized will be a Hasselblad 70mm general-purpose still camera, which will be used to capture all other aspects of the trip. Inside the Command and Service Module spacecraft, there is also a color television camera that will enable the crew to dump live images to the ground during the transit periods. Finally, for live television from the lunar surface, the second-ever ground-commanded television assembly, or GCTA, will be a part of 16's lunar roving vehicle. First flown on Apollo 15, this incredible camera is seeing yet another upgrade for the mission of Apollo 16. A small North Hollywood video company called Image Transform, established by a former Canadian Broadcasting Corporation employee named John Lowry, tested a landmark new method of video noise reduction on the television feed from Apollo 15's TV camera. Separating areas of motion and noise from the static portions of the picture, Image Transform was able to continuously blend frames of video to create new, cleaner frames. Video that was largely free of the static and visual noise of the original unprocessed signal. Just 2 months before the launch of Apollo 16, John Lowry showed the results to astronaut Jim McDivitt, and they were so impressive that NASA immediately contracted Image Transform to serve as a signal processing middleman.
It is called image enhancement. With a picture so free from interference, scientists can study the planet over television. For instance, when NASA officials saw this enhanced version of the blastoff, they discovered a few extra parts flying around they hadn't seen before. The television picture is electronically taken apart and then by computer put back together much clearer. It all happens at a young company in North Hollywood, California, Image Transform Incorporated. Apollo 16 pictures will travel from the moon to California's Goldstone Receiving Station to Houston's NASA headquarters, back to the small building in North Hollywood for enhancement, then again to Houston for the world to see, all in less than a second. Compared with the multi-billion dollar NASA facilities, these offices could fit in a broom closet. And that's about where the young company is keeping its secrets, but the product sells itself. turning round images into distinct rocks and crevices.
This, plus the addition of a glare shield to prevent lens flare, would mean that the television pictures from Apollo 16 would far exceed those from 15 in terms of quality and clarity. Apollo 16's launch vehicle, AS-511, is rolled out to the pad in mid-December 1971 for a launch in March of 1972. But almost immediately, the problem started. Abnormalities detected in the lunar module batteries, flexibility issues in Charles Duke's EVA suit, and concerns over the health of the pyrotechnic system used to make the final separation between the CSM and the LEM in orbit over the moon after the landing all contributes to a painful but necessary decision to roll the entire vehicle back from the pad into the vehicle assembly building to make the necessary modifications. It is the first time a vehicle is rolled back due to serious technical malfunctions, and the launch is delayed a month, from mid-March to mid-April. During this time, accidental damage is inflicted upon a fuel tank in the service module. The tank and the other systems are modified or replaced, tested, and on the 9th of February 1972, the vehicle is restacked and rolled out to the pad again. The launch date had been selected, April 16th.
It gets very quiet, but somewhere out there, machines are running softly, radar is tracking, and computers are ticking away in the night. And when you look at the moon from Cape Kennedy, it makes you think of a lot of things. It makes you think about the Earth, moving through space around the sun and revolving at 900 miles an hour. And you think about Cape Kennedy as a sort of a platform on that moving, revolving object. And you realize that they send rockets from here which have to travel a quarter of a million miles out into space and land precisely on another revolving object which itself is rushing through space at 2,000 miles an hour. It's enough to give a man a headache. But one is also led to think about the magic of the moon. And when you look at it from here, well, it's not an invention. Man has walked on the moon. It's just that when you look at the moon, that's hard to believe.
Technology has brought the world together, I thought, this communications revolution. And there's a lot of great things come out of the internet. And all of that was rooted back in Apollo, in early space age. And I look at my mobile phone now, and it's got 800,000 times the memory of my Apollo computer in my hand. Yeah, it's amazing.
Apollo 16, this is the ROM. The launch team wishes you good luck and Godspeed.
Well, we appreciate that. We can't do without you.
This is Kennedy Launch Control, Launch Operations Manager Paul Donnelly just called the three astronauts and said that the Apollo 16 launch team wishes them good luck and Godspeed. They all replied thank you, and we now have a quiet circuit as they switch over to the Astrocom circuit. We're now T-minus 3 minutes, 24 seconds and counting. We're approaching the time when the countdown goes on the terminal sequencer. The sequencer commands a variety of functions, all which must occur in the proper sequence for the count to continue.
Drinking water, rocket fuel, cryogenics. All the necessary volatiles and consumables were then loaded into the spacecraft and rocket stages. The momentum was picking up. The mission was a go. A gyroscope malfunction in the S-4B's IU threatens to delay the launch yet again just 40 minutes before the planned liftoff. The launch control team holds their breath as last-minute diagnostics are made. A decision finally comes through. Press on. Go for launch.
The instrument unit light, panel light now on the status board indicates instrument unit ready, spacecraft ready, emergency detection system ready. We've passed the 2-minute, 50-second mark, and we're now on the terminal sequencer. Terminal sequencer has started. This terminal sequencer will pressurize the fuel tank. These fuel tanks are pressurized to ensure that as the fuels deplete, they are forced down for to assure an even flow into the engine. Fuel tanks are now being pressurized. The S4B, or third stage liquid oxygen tank, has just been pressurized, and the second stage liquid oxygen tank has been pressurized. As we move down through the count at the T-minus 17 second mark, we'll get a release of the guidance system in the instrument unit. Also handled by the automatic sequencer will be the release of swing arms number one and number two. At the T-minus 3 minute mark, tape recorders on board the spacecraft were turned on. These recorders record both voice and data. Spacecraft now to full internal cooling. The cooling load has been shared with a ground cooling. T-minus 90 seconds and counting. T-minus 90 seconds and counting. At T-minus 1 minute 15 seconds, the spacecraft batteries will be turned on for launch. These batteries will give an additional power source. T-minus 1 minute, T-minus 1 minute and counting. Now moving into the final minute of the count. We'll be standing by for the switch over to internal power. Switch over taking place at this time, going on internal power. T-minus 45 seconds and counting. Guidance align just announced by John Young. That will be the last action taken by the crew aboard the spacecraft. T-minus 35 and counting. Countdown continuing to go well. T-minus 30. T-minus 25, 24, 23, 22, 21, 20, 19, 18, 17. Guidance release. 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9. We have ignition sequence start. The engine is now building up to 7.7 million pounds of thrust. We have a launch commit and we have a liftoff. The swing arms moving back. The Saturn V lifting off the pound. Alpha pad building up thrust. We clear the tower.
Thrust. Oh, yes, good thrust in all five.
Roger.
Right on time, 12:54 p.m. Eastern Standard, April 16th, 1972. Apollo 16 ventures skyward. During the first 2 minutes and 42 seconds of flight, while the rocket is powered by its first stage, the S1C, every motion the vehicle makes is done on a clockwork pre-programmed timer. The vehicle is simply following what it has already been told to do. This is known as a closed-loop guidance system. It isn't until some 40 seconds into the second stage that the active steering guidance software takes over control of the vehicle.
Staging. After ignition on the S2.
Roger. Go on all five on the S2. Steering has converged, the CMC is go.
Roger. Roger, looks good up here too. Hey, Gordy, you ought to see that horizon. Just gorgeous.
The onboard computer makes decisions and attitude maneuvers in real time based on a set of inertial gyroscopes and onboard accelerometers in order to follow the most fuel-efficient trajectory towards its target orbit, with the astronauts intently monitoring the values and ensuring the computer's decisions make sense. Apollo 16 enters a nominal Earth orbit, and the countdown to the next important mission milestone begins.
It wasn't a spiritual experience, nor even a philosophical experience. To me, I describe my time on the moon as an adventure, probably the most exciting adventure I'd ever been on. I appreciated the beauty. That was wondrous and very emotional. But it wasn't life-changing at the time. We just looked at it as doing our job and having fun doing it. Nobody expected fame from being a moonwalker or an opportunity that we had. We appreciated it, but nobody thought about, when I get back, how am I going to handle this hero stuff? Nobody thought about it. Even though we were the fifth landing and almost 3 years after Neil Armstrong, I still had not developed that, well, I'm going to go to the moon, I'm going to be famous like Neil Armstrong. It just didn't matter. Nobody thought about it. Nobody cared about it, if you will.
Checking over all their systems and making optical alignments for their guidance computer, John, Charlie, and Ken prepare their vehicle for its most important burn, translunar injection. A potential problem develops which concerns mission control. One of the attitude control jet packages located near the base of the third stage, called an APS, or Auxiliary Propulsion System module, is showing higher than normal helium pressures. It is designed to vent helium into space in order to regulate such pressures, but this may result in it running out of helium before the third stage concludes its TLI burn, meaning John would have to steer the booster manually using the service module RCS quads. Everyone watches the system as the vehicle inches closer to TLI.
Apollo 16, Houston. We're seeing some pressure, overpressure in EPS module number 2, and it has gradually increased now up around the 320 range. And there's a relief valve which will relieve helium pressure at 325 and reseat when the pressure gets down to 225.
Stand by.
Enjoy the view there.
Yeah, we're just starting to come into darkness now, and the sunset is just as beautiful as always in this space business.
Roger, wish I was there with you.
And you can even see stars.
Once again, the crew lucks out.
16 Houston, your go for TLI.
Roger, go for TLI.
We're about a minute and a half to LOS. No further updates, everything looks good. The apps module is looking good.
16, Roger. Everything looks normal here.
16, we're showing good thrust on S4B.
Roger.
Roger, we're looking good here.
That's what it looks like. We're looking at minus 10 on the Delta B.
Roger.
Come.
Roger.
Separation, turnaround, transposition, and docking. All go swimmingly well, and the crew finally extracts their lunar module from the third stage.
Houston, this is the most spectacular view you could possibly imagine. The most spectacular view I've ever seen.
However, during this time, the three notice an abnormally high level of particles shedding from the backside of the lunar module ascent stage, near some mylar insulation by a reaction control system thruster. It is such an unusual phenomenon that the crew is given the go-ahead to enter the LEM and briefly power it up on the first day to ensure the health of its systems.
16 Houston, the booster is in attitude and stable. You have a go for RTND.
Okay, Houston, you got the high gain?
Okay, we're coming up on 5940 mark.
Okay, Houston, you ought to be getting some TV.
We got a picture now, Charlie, and it looks real good.
Man, it just looks like a picture book from up here, Gordo. We must have a zillion particles along with us.
Roger, we see the particles, and great picture.
Gordy, looks like Orion is hanging in there pretty well. She looks great.
Looks the same to us.
Put out now, Houston.
Roger, looks like a real smooth join-up.
Okay, Houston, we're hard docked.
Roger, John, we saw it come in.
And there is no question when you get the ledges.
Yep.
From what they can see, everything looks good. While it remains unexplained during the mission, post-mission analysis would reveal that in accordance with modifications made to the spacecraft for the J missions, of which Apollo 16 is the second, the lunar module's RCS propellants were colder and denser than they had been on previous landings. This, combined with the fact that several external panels on the lunar module were painted white, caused the surface of the lunar module to become much colder than it ever had been before. Somewhere around minus 100 degrees Celsius, the paint began to peel and flake off. For the next flight, NASA will withhold painting the panels, since the paint itself adds little thermal value.
And Pete, every time the one of the command module, service module RCS plus X jet fires, towards that that one over the hatch here, it really blows that stuff off.
Very nice picture, Charlie. We can see southwestern United States, lower California. Very nice.
Good. Kent's doing all that good work for you. It's out his window.
Gordy, is that color okay for you?
Very nice, Ken. Beautiful color.
I bet it's good, but you just can't believe how beautiful it is. See the reds in the desert down there in the southern United States and northern part of Mexico. And from here you see the Great Lakes and the state of Florida out there, and it's just absolutely something. We're going to go back to work, but thought you'd enjoy that.
Thank you for the picture. It's the next best thing to being up there.
Houston, Casper is out of his bag. And we got the S4B in the window. And the TV is transmitting pictures of it now, and if you want to do your maneuver with it, we're well clear.
The maneuver, attitude maneuver is in progress now.
Roger, we can see it maneuvering. I tell you, they never make movies like these.
We can see her moving away now, Gordon, and she's just slowly picking up a little speed there. The only way you can tell it's moving is against the particles in the background. Looks like there's a million stars out behind the S4B as it moves off.
We got another spectacular view of the Earth down here, the polar ice cap. We can see the whole sphere, and the United States is absolutely spectacular.
And the other side, we've got a crescent moon.
In fact, you can see Lake Mead, Gordy. Very clearly.
No kidding. The vapor burn is complete now.
Now, Roger, if she moves out of sight, the old Apollo 16 crew would really like to express their thanks and appreciation to the guys at the Marshall Space Flight Center that give such a phenomenal ride. Not to mention the Boeing Company on the first stage, North American on the second, MacDAC on the third, IBM on the IU. It was superb all the way.
Gordy, on that booze, that S1C is a real freight train, I'll tell you, boy. Can't get over that. Can't get over the view of that Earth. None of the pictures just do it justice. Absolutely beautiful.
I'll tell you, you can't wait too many years to make this worth it.
It had been an exhausting day, but the problems encountered were either minor headaches or close calls that ultimately didn't amount to anything. 9 hours after launch, the crew finally began their first rest period.
Looking at the lights of the city through fog, and then there were others that were clear. Something well worth remembering to look for.
Roger. I'll be sure to remind Ron to look for that one.
Glad there, Houston. How you doing?
Hey, you sound good. Good morning up there. How are you doing?
Sure beats work. Okay, you can see near it out there. About the same size. No, stop the other one. And Africa is clear this morning. At least the part that we can see, which is what usually clear, right around the Canaries.
Very good. We've got you about you just passed 100,000 miles on our chart here. And I've got a input from Dottie here for Charlie. She says your five bird eggs have hatched, and so you've got five new healthy neighbors.
Oh, great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Tony, just enjoy seeing this place. After all the things you had to go through to keep the cockpit nice and clean out there, you'd never recognize it.
Well, it probably looks like any bachelor's pad.
38 hours and 20 minutes into flight, towards the end of flight day 2, another issue develops. This time concerning a system that no one can afford to see malfunction. The guidance computer. While he is making star sightings, Ken Mattingly notices a cockpit warning light associated with a no attitude and gimbal lock state. The computer, for no apparent reason, has lost platform reference and has no idea where the spacecraft is pointed. It also believes the rate gyroscopes are in a state of gimbal lock and has frozen the IMU.
Okay, I'm not sure what just happened. I just saw, down looking at the optics, and all of a sudden I saw a warning light. I got a no attitude and a gimbal lock light. And my ball seems to, in fact, looks like the platform may be frozen.
Casper Houston, we'd like you to hold up on the Bird 41920. We're working on a procedure to try to get rid of the gimbal lock.
The guidance computer reads data coming out of an inertial measurement unit, or IMU. Inside this IMU is a series of three nested gimbals set at right angles to each other. Each gimbal monitors a certain dimension of attitude movement, roll, pitch, and yaw. However, if the outer gimbal, which is rigidly locked to the spacecraft, comes into alignment with an inner gimbal axis, the two become locked into a single plane, and 1 degree of freedom, an entire dimension of attitude measurement, is lost. The two gimbals are now locked to each other, and any impulse would move them both simultaneously. The Apollo guidance computer has a built-in safety mechanism designed to prevent a full mechanical gimbal lock. When two gimbals drift dangerously close to each other, the computer flashes a warning light. If they come to within 5 degrees, the computer freezes the IMU entirely and won't continue until a full platform realignment is performed by the crew. This is evidently what the computer did, though the cause is unknown. 16's attitude was nowhere near the dangerous zone. No actual gimbal lock condition existed. The crew and mission control begin sweating bullets for the next 2 hours, as Mattingly performs a full platform realignment in accordance with mission procedures.
The astronauts are faced with another guidance problem, that of determining their attitude or the direction the spacecraft is facing. The astronaut navigator finds a known star in the wide-angle telescope. Using a fingertip control, he changes the attitude of the spacecraft to bring the star into line. Once he has the star in position in the telescope, he moves the optical sextant. He lines the sextant up with the star and makes a reading. He must repeat the process with another known star so that he has two readings to give to the onboard computer. From this information, the computer determines the attitude of the spacecraft.
To make things even more complicated, paint particles are still shedding off the lunar module, making a star alignment impossible. So Mattingly instead has to use the sun and moon. The ultimate cause was narrowed down to the electrical system. Sometimes, with mechanical switches and relays, two contacts which are forcefully pushed together can bounce, connecting one or more times before making steady contact. The result is a rapidly pulsed electric current instead of a clean transition from zero to full. The effect is usually unimportant, but in this case, a voltage spike caused by a contact bounce led to a current transient in the electrical system, which was electromagnetically coupled into the middle gimbal angle data unit, erroneously setting the 90-degree monitoring bit inside the guidance computer. It was a one-in-a-million malfunction, one which certainly caused the crew to lose some sleep, but not one which threatened the mission. Seconds, minutes, hours tick away as Apollo 16 nears the moon. As the combined Apollo spacecraft traverses the black shadow of our neighbor, the crew inside begin taking photographs of the unveiled universe around them, briefly unhindered from the blinding light of our star. Ultraviolet photography, the in-flight electrophoresis experiment, and the light flash experiments were successfully performed by the crew. Numerous flashes were reported by each crewman. They are visible with either open or closed eyes, and they are described as leaving no afterglow, were instantaneous, and were white in color. 74 hours, 28 minutes, 27 seconds. LOI. Casper burns retrograde, pushing itself and Orion into lunar orbit.
Hello, Houston. Suite 16 has arrived.
Roger, 16. Copy you loud and clear.
Okay, Pete, super double fantastic burn.
Now you're talking. That's the best news ever today, so far.
And as you can see, we're at 170.4 by 58.3, according to the old computer, and that baby just rifled it right down the line.
Alrighty.
And everybody's looking out the window. And right now, we're looking right down at Crater King. And it's just as fantastic as it always has been.
The next day, the crew awaken and separate into their respective spacecraft. John and Charlie go into the LEM, while Mattingly stays behind. The pair need to power up Orion and load its onboard computers with all the necessary information for lunar landing. They need to prepare other systems too, such as pressurizing their RCS jets and establishing a stable, independent link of communication with mission control. It is on this last task that a major malfunction occurs again. The S-band steerable antenna, which is located on top of the ascent stage, would not move in yaw when commanded. Regardless of whether it was sent to a certain coordinate through the computer or manually slewed by the astronauts. Upon close examination, it appeared a stow latch had failed to release. It was stuck. The astronauts could do nothing about it. It could only be fixed by going EVA, something which Apollo 16 did not have time for. They needed to land on the moon now. Every second is lost time. Every lunar orbit is one step closer to running out of consumables. Time is their most precious commodity. A quick and dirty decision is made. Forget the steerable S-band antenna. Instead of beaming data directly into the lunar module computer, Mission Control will read it up, and Charlie would have to punch it in manually. Each one of the vectors he enters involves 18 separate five-digit numbers, plus a time tag. Charlie has to enter them all, with no mistakes. Running behind schedule, at 96 hours into the flight, Orion and Casper finally undock.
Hello, Houston, all Orion, how do you read, over?
Orion, this is Houston, read you loud and clear.
Okay, Jim, we're zipping right on through the checklist. We got the pings up, the docks, of course, aligned, done. The landing gear is deployed.
Hey, Jim, one of those drink bags, say it's pretty hard to see things when you got a helmet full of orange juice at zero gravity, something with that orange juice.
Hey, you got to drink fast.
You really do. And, Jim, we had to turn on our window heaters for about 10 minutes per side to clear up the windows right before undocking.
The two spacecraft disappear behind the lunar horizon, beginning the far side pass of Rev number 12. Mission Control waits for them to reappear on the other side of the moon. During this time, Mattingly will need to fire his service propulsion system engine to circularize his orbit. John and Charlie, meanwhile, will stay in the elliptical descent orbit with the low point over the landing site and prepare for their own burn, PDI, powered descent ignition. The circ burn performed by the CSM has been a part of normal mission procedure since Apollo 14, but as Casper reappears over the lunar surface, the news is not good. No circ. Mattingly did not make the circularization burn. In preparing the engine for its eventual firing, Mattingly found that a redundant set of servos used to control the engine suffered from incredibly abnormal oscillations. The SPS engine used by the CSM can gimbal or swivel, which allows the vehicle to maintain attitude control during burns, as well as ensuring it is always symmetrically thrusting into the vehicle's center of mass, which can shift depending on whether or not a lunar lander is attached. The servo system, called TVC, or Thrust Vector Control, is a series of electrically driven actuators that can gimbal the engine in pitch and yaw. In a situation that had been developing since the LOI burn, it seemed the secondary servos were wobbling the engine around wildly, a degree in every direction. They were unable to settle down and find their true aim point. Although the primary system still worked perfectly, mission rules dictated that both systems must be operational before a separation burn can commence.
Yep, and telegram when you go around.
Okay. Weather. Weather ready to start the day, huh?
Yep.
We'll be requesting high bed rate shortly.
Roger.
And we're ready for high bed rate now.
Copy, no sir.
We copied, no sir.
Do you have high bed rate?
It was a malfunction deep in the guts of the service module. Something that Mattingly was in no way responsible for and could do nothing about. Just an hour prior to their scheduled lunar landing, John and Charlie are given the first ever wave off. No go. They are instead commanded to continue station keeping with Casper, maintain a state of rendezvous, and drift there in lunar orbit while Mission Control studies the problem. John and Charlie look down as they pass over their landing site, painfully aware that they may have just lost their chance to land on the moon. According to the book, the only thing left to do now was to dock and head back to Earth, before more problems develop with the command and service module engine. All three astronauts wait and hope for anything that might salvage their seemingly doomed mission. Had they really come all this way just to be denied at the last minute?
How long do you think it's going to take them to get rendezvous, Jerry?
I think your estimate of a couple of three res.
Looks to me now like I'm drifting the other way.
Not according to my needles.
Okay, I'll believe your needles.
Ryan, request you select the secondary transmitter and receiver.
As you get them back together, get the things back that they want them, get them mentally prepared to do what they're going to do.
But now, don't take that as input. I'm not asking you to pitch down out loud. I want to say something else I'm sure of.
I don't see any way we can continue on.
Okay, Ken, you're at 5,600 feet, close at 4 feet.
16, no answers yet. We're still looking at it.
We should make sure that that's calm, but there's no way, we don't have any other redundancy or other routes.
Word's coming back kind of initially from North America that they're suspecting a late feedback.
Building 45 is Jim McDivitt.
An hour goes by, no word from the ground. Another hour passes. Orbit after orbit. All the while, electrical power is being consumed. Coolant water is being run. Every minute they spend drifting in orbit is a minute lost on the surface of the moon.
Go ahead.
I mean, then it's full speed ahead.
I just don't much see how we can make it on this next trip. I think you guys ought to continue to work.
So you'd only do it if you had a failure on the primary. Well, how would you ever get the damn thing trimmed then?
I would. If I had a failure in a primary, I'd shut it down.
Yeah, but I want you guys to go simulate it.
NASA reaches out to the manufacturer of the command and service module, North American Aviation, and, together with their contractors, exhaustively test the problem. The results, 6 hours later, were finally starting to come in. It appears that, for some reason, an electrical circuit in the rate feedback system of the secondary servos had failed to close. The actuators were having trouble exactly determining where the engine bell was pointed. But there was a ray of hope. During a burn, the guidance computer would be able to judge the thrust vector of the spacecraft based on its accelerometers. A judgment is finally made on the ground. While not unanimous, the majority believed that while slightly higher than normal oscillations could be expected, it wouldn't be life-threatening. The word was go for landing.
Okay, when you come up on AOS, on the next rev 15, we'll give you a go or no go for another try.
Manned Spacecraft Center Director Dr. Christopher C. Kraft Jr. just came back into the control center after having attended a meeting by management people in one of the back rooms, and the situation is go for landing.
Well, have at it, babe. So we're going to try.
You do have a go for another try here at the PDI on Rev 16.
6 hours behind schedule, Casper finally makes the meager 5-second circularization burn and enters the parking orbit. All eyes are now on John and Charlie as Orion begins its final descent to the hills of Descartes. John and Charlie have spent months studying their landing site. At the moment of pitch over, when the LEM tilts up and the astronauts can see the lunar surface for the first time, Charlie and John will be scanning outside to try and familiarize themselves with where they are. Charlie will call out landmarks and descent velocity data, while John flies the spacecraft in for a landing. This was the ultimate moment.
Well, let me say, before, for the 4 or 5 hours before that, my emotions went from the depths to the mountaintop. So we were really down, but then mission control came through as usual and solved the problem.
Ryan, you're go for PDI.
Roger, go for PDI.
Okay. Stand by for 2 minutes, John.
Roger.
Hey, 2 minutes, master arm on.
Minutes, master arm's on, two lights.
Roger, copy, two lights.
Incoming mode select. B-67 is in. Next thing is at 30 seconds, John. Turn the page. If it's all right, start. Man, override is on. Check your throttling, man.
Roger, we copy.
Hey, decent command override, master arm off.
Master arm is coming off.
Stand by for throttle up. Thrust to weight is okay.
2, 23, 24, 25, 26.
Throttle up. On time. Feel that beauty? Come on.
Roger, we copy.
Hey, thrust to weight is good. feet. They were right on.
Right now looks pretty good.
Hey Jim, pitch over. Do you want me to go aft Omni or stay forward?
Stay forward and you've got to go at one.
Roger. Hey, we're way high, John. We got to get down. Way
right.
High on the H dot.
Put it, Charlie. Down to 45 already.
H and Pink's are tracking right on, Jim.
Roger.
Within a tenth of a foot a second. Look at that. Altitude velocity lights are out at 50K. Isn't that amazing? 21,000. Coming up on 8 minutes.
Ryan, you're going at 8.
Back to see the landing site from here, Charlie.
Amazing. Okay, go at 8. John's got a visual. Okay, we're going to be right on. Just about right on, maybe 10 feet. 10,000 feet.
Be 64 at 8,200.
Pro.
Pitch over.
Pitch over. And there he is, Gator, Lone Star. Right on.
I'll be the same, Charlie.
Okay, 40 degrees, 38 degrees.
Right
on. Down on dot, north ray.
Okay.
Looks like we're going to be able to make it, John. There's not too many blocks up there.
Ryan, you're going
okay,
for landing.
Okay, 4,000 feet.
Go for landing.
42 LPD.
42.
Okay, 3,900 feet.
Okay, two to the south, Charlie.
Okay. It's in. Okay, 41 LPD, 3,000 feet on profile.
Okay, there's, we're coming right down. It's gonna be a little fast.
Okay, 41 LPD.
Okay.
22 down at 500 feet. Okay. The big blocks over here to the left, John. Okay, fuel is good, 10%. That comes a shadow. Okay, 200 feet. Perfect place over here, John. A couple of big boulders. Not too bad. Down at 3. Looking super. There's dust. I'm gonna let her down. You level off. Let her on down. Contact. Stop. Okay, 413. Oh, Orion is finally here, Houston.
Fantastic.
And,
go aft
on me, Orion. Okay, we're forward to the north, forward and to the north, double spot. I would guess about 200 meters to the north and maybe 150 meters to the west.
Comfort. Roger, I copy 200 meters north, double spot, and about 150 meters west.
And I could see the, I could see all the way to the ground, just like flying the LTV. Piece of cake.
So we were very excited about the landing. You know, we're here. Old Orion is finally here, Houston. I screamed to Mission Control, fantastic. And we started describing every rock that we could see out of the window and all of these things. And
fantastic. Percy Precision is planted one on the plains of Descartes. Well, camera stopped.
I better go easy on this landing radar Zergerberger, huh?
Yeah, don't... Okay, that's the right one. Hey, camera's off.
Uh-huh.
Hey, it sure ain't flat, John. Wow, there's that ridge to the north. Where we landed, there were...
Hey, man, Charlie. We got to stay, Houston?
Stand by. Orion, your stay for T1.
Hats off in a case of beer to Fido. I'll tell you, that targeting was just beautiful. Boy, you guys just started us right in there. That was superb.
Our flight plan called us to get out right away to explore our first excursion. But due to the 6-hour delay, we ended up having a very extended day if we did that. So they decided, let's go to sleep. So we took off our spacesuits, put up our hammocks in the spacecraft and tried to go to sleep. But you can imagine 4 or 5 hours after landing on the moon, and they said, go to sleep. Well, John had a lot of experience at these kind of events, so he went off to sleep. But I was also on the communications helmet that we call the Snoopy hat. And I was, if Mission Control called, I would hear it. They told me there was going to be an alarm 3 or 4 hours later, and this is what it's going to be. And anyway, I'm just keyed up, you know. And finally, 4 hours later, the alarm had gone off. And I said to Mission Control, I said, I'm taking a sleeping pill. I can't get to sleep. So they allowed me to do that, and I took one. So I got about 3-4 hours of sleep that night. And then the next day, we started our normal routine.
The original schedule called for John and Charlie to begin EVA-1 immediately after landing. But the original schedule also assumed a landing at 98 hours, not 104 hours. The consumables and EVA planning teams now feel the pressure, as they need to ascertain whether or not 3 moonwalks are even still possible, with the LEM some 6 hours below where it should be at this point in the flight. One decision is certain. John and Charlie will sleep first and go outside tomorrow. Everyone wants 16 to make 3 full moonwalks, but at this point, they're lucky just to have landed. Only 2 of the 3 planned days on the moon are now guaranteed. Everyone will have to just wait and see how quickly the rest of the consumable levels fall before a final word is given as to whether or not they can stay for a third day. 119 hours after launch, April 21st, 1972. John Young becomes the 9th man to walk on the surface of the moon. Charlie Duke becomes the 10th. There had been some concern regarding Charlie's spacesuit. He had struggled with it the entire flight, complaining that it was too tight. When the pair depressurized the LEM, the pressurized suit ballooned out slightly and the problem was gone. Charlie's suit was now a perfect fit. Like any of the previous lunar surface phases, Mission Control remains relaxed but vigilant. Gene Kranz and his white team, who have been assigned to handle the ascent from the lunar surface, remain on alert for any issues. The astronauts must be able to lift off from the lunar surface within 2 hours of any problem developing. If a flight controller couldn't get to the Moker from their house in less than 30 minutes, then they had to sleep inside the MCC during the surface phase. The pair deploy their rover without any issues whatsoever, and attach the Lunar Communications Relay Unit, or LCRU, so that they can establish a solid television picture.
Crew now getting ready to deploy the lunar roving vehicle.
Charlie.
It's raining, John.
Look at it go, would you, Charlie?
You got all your steering. It's great.
Oh, this is going to be some kind of different ride.
The rotor is running, Houston.
416 is the neatest environment you can find for this kind of work.
Apollo 16's glorious first images broadcast from the lunar surface.
We're getting our communications now through the lunar communications relay unit, the suitcase-sized communications package that will be carried on the rover, and we should be getting television shortly.
Hey, we've got a picture.
Hey! Of the ground, no doubt.
Out of the ground.
That's it.
Yeah. That's nice-looking ground.
Hey, the camera is running. The 16-millimeter is running.
Outstanding.
Absolutely.
Oh, is this easy to do?
Personally, anyway.
Gravity. I really like it. This is about the neatest thing I ever saw.
Hey, you're looking at me with the big eye.
All right, the big eye's on you, Charlie. Let me see if you're nervous, Charlie.
Super.
You're in living color.
I just tried to blow off the dust, Tony. This is so super.
Oh, boy.
That Percy Precision Young was coming right straight down when he hit. We didn't move an inch on those footpads.
Well, it was, of course, very, very exciting to land on the moon. One of the primary reasons we didn't think we were going to get to land, we had a very serious problem that developed in the other spacecraft about 1 hour before we were to land. And so we had to abort the landing. And so you can imagine how depressed we were, but we orbited twice and mission control said, well, we know the problem, we can't fix the problem, but here's the way to work around the problem. And so now we're gonna give you a go for landing. We had some problems also, but nothing as serious as Apollo 11. And John made a terrific landing in the middle of the Kali Plains and the mountains of the moon. And we were almost dead level in attitude when we touched down. Very exciting now, we're on the moon and we just erupted with joy, if you will. And I screamed out, "Old Orion," which was our call sign. "Old Orion is finally here, Houston, fantastic." As Buzz Aldrin said, "Magnificent desolation." So it's one of the most spectacular places I'd ever seen. Untouched, unspoiled. You had this reverence about it almost. I'm on the moon. Nobody's ever been here before. And yet you felt the excitement, the awe, the beauty, all of those feelings were in within, but you were having fun doing it.
You are black from the knees down already.
No, I had to go, I've been on my knees twice to get there.
Okay, Tony, we start the LMP's camera for the flag. Hey, John, this is perfect with the limb and the rover and you and Stone Mountain and the old flag. Come on out here and give me a salute. Big Navy salute.
Look at this. That's a pretty outstanding picture here, I tell you.
Come on a little bit closer. Okay, here we go, a big one. Off the ground, before.
I'd like to see an Air Force salute, Charlie, but I don't think they salute the Air Force.
Sure, we do. And fly high and straight and land soft.
Okay, Charlie, say when.
Here we go.
Good again.
One for you. Okay, one more.
This looks like a good time for some good news here. The House passed a space budget yesterday, 277 to 60, which includes a vote for the shuttle.
Tony, again, I'll say it with that salute. I'm proud to be an American. I'll tell you, what a program, and what a place, and what an experience.
Yeah, and I'll say it too. So my country needs that shuttle mighty bad. You'll see.
Well, while we were on the moon on Apollo 16, the Capcom told us that Congress had approved the space shuttle program. And the space program, the space shuttle was Earth orbit. So we retreated back to Earth orbit and decided to start doing more and more science in space, human physiology, and understanding the environment around us. And so now we're stuck in Earth orbit as long as the shuttle was there, and it was an expensive program. Every flight was a couple hundred million dollars, and it was a reusable spacecraft, but it took a lot to get it ready after every flight. And so we didn't have any money left over to continue manned flight into the moon. And so the moon flights were terminated. We still had unmanned flights to Mars and to Hubble telescope we put up, and things like that.
9 years from now, almost to the date, April 12, 1981, John Young would himself command the first flight of the shuttle into orbit, STS-1. Charlie and John move out to the ALSEP site to deploy their mission's battery of scientific experiments. There are several unique experiments that flew to the moon aboard 16. One of them is a tripod-mounted, 3-inch electronographic Schmidt camera with a cesium iodide cathode and a film cartridge. This small surface telescope will be operated by John Young and can take ultraviolet pictures of Earth and other deep sky objects. The so-called far UV experiment will make observations over the next 51 hours. It is able to see objects over 100 times fainter than can be seen with the human eye.
Yeah, it is maybe a quarter. It's right in the middle.
Outstanding. You did a good down sun alignment.
The crescent is right in the middle of that scope. I might move it a half a degree, but I wouldn't move it any more.
Another unique experiment is a small series of detector plates made of various glasses and plastics and metal foils mounted to a bar that was leaned against one of the legs of the lunar module. This experiment would use the various materials to measure cosmic rays, which create microscopic penetrations inside the media. The composition and energy of any given particle striking the detector could be determined from the shape and depth of the microscopic track. A couple experiments are flying on 16, which only flew previously on 14. They include an active seismic experiment, a thumper and mortar setup to generate artificial seismic waves designed to help a network of geophones map underground structures, and a portable magnetometer that can take localized readings. Unlike on 14, this time, the magnetometer experiment benefits from the presence of the lunar rover, which can carry it much further than an astronaut on foot. Finally, Charlie will periodically use a spike to penetrate the lunar soil at various points across the exploration area as part of a soil mechanics experiment to determine the strength of the lunar surface to compaction.
Look out, here it comes, hot stuff. Houston, I got about 20 meters away and the RTG package fell off. It hit the dirt with a ton, like a bomb. It got a little dusty, but the fins are okay and all the experiments seem to be intact.
Good, so Charlie. We want to make sure we knock the dust off those connectors before we take the caps off of them.
I agree. Okay, it seems to be locked now, Tony. I don't know what happened. It just,
On Apollo 15, the astronauts attempted to drill holes into the lunar surface in order to emplace temperature probes that would ideally be able to measure underground heat flow. The fiberglass drill stems flown on that flight were not strong enough to break beyond a few meters of soil, and the heat flow probes on 15 were only planted about half as deep as scientists had originally wanted them to be. That mistake would not be made on Apollo 16. John and Charlie's drill stems are titanium. Finally, NASA would be able to obtain the long-sought data of subsurface heat flow, something which would illustrate how quickly the moon cooled during its formative years.
Okay, it's working. It's working. It's moving. Good. Yeah, it's going like
a champ. Good show. Everything looks good.
Everybody looked like that we'd been filthy up there, and there's several reasons for that. We fell down, and we had in the cars, I was saying, and so, and playing, not playing with the rocks, but collecting rocks, you just got dust all over it, and it was so fine you couldn't brush it off. We had special brushes, but it didn't work, and it was, so you ended up turning gray.
Okay, are you guys ready? Here we go. Mark. Hey, that beauty is going right in.
Outstanding.
Guess what?
It slowed down.
Stop going in. Something hard in there. Whatever it was, we got through it, Tony. It's speeding up again.
Okay, good show.
Right on down now. All
right.
For now. It must have been a rock. I'm
very good,
okay,
Charlie.
Okay, the long stem is in.
Golly, Charlie.
Okay, we copy that.
Or so the scientists who designed the experiment had thought. The wires and cables that connected the ALSEP experiments to the central computer were tightly wound and stored prior to launch. In the 1/6 gravity of the moon, they had the tendency to retain their coiled shape. What should have been a series of flat wires resting flush against the lunar surface was instead a spaghettified mess on the moon, just waiting for that unfortunate astronaut to ensnare their foot and cause millions of dollars worth of damage. That unfortunate astronaut would be John Young.
Okay, Baker 7 and 8.
Charlie,
what?
Something happened here.
What happened?
I don't know. Here's a line that pulled loose.
Uh-oh.
What is that? What line is it?
That's the heat flow. You pulled it off.
I don't know how that happened.
Yeah.
God almighty.
Now I'm wasting my time.
Kind of sorry. I didn't even know it. It broke right at the connector.
The wire came off at the connector.
Okay, we copy. Okay, I guess we can forget the rest of that heat flow.
All right.
I'm sorry, Charlie. God damn, I didn't even know it.
It's a bunch of spaghetti over there.
Well, we can sure see that on TV. It looks like a mess. A day ago, it didn't look like we were even going to land, and now we've sampled our first highlands. I feel pretty good about the science without the heat flow.
Well, I know Mark's disappointed, and I sure am. Frankly, that was just a real shame.
He had inadvertently ripped the cables for the heat flow experiment straight off the connector. Mission Control would seek a fix, but the effort was fruitless. There was just no way. Heat flow data on 16 is a bust. It would have to wait yet again.
Well, that means you've got to mate all those wires, separate wires in there, and have them insulated from one another.
That's right.
And if that doesn't occur, what are the chances of shorting out the central station?
Well, that's another one that they're working.
It is an event that will haunt John for the rest of the mission.
You want two pans?
Yeah, we would like two pans. John said.
But he knows, as well as anyone, that there is no time to mourn. Keep moving, keep working. Every second is precious on the moon. The astronauts have no choice but to move on.
Ben McMahon. 3, 4, 5, 6.
Three and a half hours into EVA-1, the pair power up their rover and prepare to embark on the first geologic traverse. This first exploration would visit an area of secondary interest. It was neither distinctly Cayley nor distinctly Descartes, but simply a medium-sized crater out to the west called Flag. The more important sites would be saved for the dedicated geologic traverses. The first moonwalk is always somewhat of a hybrid. Deployment of the ALSEP comes first and foremost. Anything after that is a second priority.
So, here we go.
And at this point, the crew has switched off the television. They're prepared now to drive across to Flag Crater, the first stop on their geology traverse on this extravehicular activity. That crater is about 1.3 kilometers distant from the ALSEP site. It'll take them about 11 minutes to get there. Following EVA-1, we expect to get a decision on the possibilities of conducting a third period of extravehicular activity. Our situation with that, with respect to that third EVA remains unchanged.
There it is. There's the buster. I mean, there's Flag. We're here. You did it.
It sure is.
We are here.
Well, congratulations.
Okay, 0-8-8 at 1.0 is...
The astronauts make it to the rim of Flag Crater and disembark to explore Geology Station 1, the first of hopefully many stopping points, places where the astronauts park their rover, get off, and explore.
Yeah, is that some crater, Tony? Woo! It's a smooth crater, very subdued, but it's really steep.
One of the things the crew hopes to sample at Flag Crater is local Cayley formation. The reason that they're interested in avoiding the ray material is that it most likely comes from South Ray Crater and would not represent the local Cayley formation.
John, you are just beautiful. That is the most beautiful sight.
What's that?
You're standing there on the rim of that crater.
Doggone, I've never heard John describe as beautiful.
No.
And have you seen any rocks that you're certain aren't wretched?
It's a
bridging. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, Tony, let me describe what it is. The top centimeter of the regolith is gray, and you get down under that, and it's white.
All right, we copy that?
Different albedo, three shades different.
Gotta be able to see that on the TV right there, Houston. All right, we can.
And they did it in 2 minutes less travel time than they were pre-planned. Fantastic.
Man, I can't wait to get back to Buster, Tony.
All right.
It's really some crater.
As you come around there, there's a rock in the near field on this rim that has some white on the top of it. We'd like you to pick it up as a grab sample.
This one right here?
That's it. You got it right there.
Okay, that's a football-sized rock. It's a Great Scott size.
Sure you want to rock that big, Houston? Yeah, let's go ahead and get it.
It's a 20 pounds of rock right there.
Okay. That's a big class in it, John. It sure is. I fall into Plum Crater getting this rock. Ballberger has had it.
Oh, yeah, I agree.
Okay, I got it. That's 20 pounds of rock.
Over the course of EVA-1, the astronauts would collect some 20 kilograms of surface samples. Most of that mass was just one rock, the one picked up at the rim of Flag Crater, nicknamed Big Muley. On their way back, they stop again, nearby two craters called Spook and Buster. Geology Station 2.
And we're looking at a few changes there at Spook. We're going to cut that station down to about 19 minutes.
Okay, water cut back.
Okay, it's your water consumption there, Charlie.
Heading back after roughly 20 minutes at Station 2, John drops Charlie off. The previous flight, Apollo 15, had been the first mission with the lunar rover. On that mission, engineers wanted high-resolution video film of the rover's operation on the moon. But a film magazine for the 16mm DAC camera set aside for this purpose had jammed. This sought-after sequence, nicknamed the Grand Prix, would be a clear demonstration of the rover's versatility and mobility. Charlie starts up his camera and points it towards John on the rover as he puts the LRV through its paces.
Let me get it set here now. It's 24. I'm going to use the trigger, so it's 24. Okay, I'm ready. Stack's on, Mark. That max acceleration? No. Man, you are really bouncing.
Is he on the ground at all?
That's 10 kilometers.
He's got about two wheels on the ground. He's a big rooster tail out of all four wheels. And as he turns, he skids. The back end breaks loose just like on snow. Come on back, John. This is really some machine. Man, I'll tell you, Andy's never seen a driver like this.
Hi, guys. This is really something.
Yahoo! Look at that thing dig in. Okay, when he hits the craters and starts bouncing, it's when he gets his rooster tail. He makes sharp turns.
Charlie.
Okay, turn sharp.
I have no desire to turn sharp. Okay, here's a sharpie.
Hey, that's great. Man, those things, when those wheels really dig in, John, when you turn, it's when you get the rooster tail. The suspension system on that thing is fantastic.
Yeah. That sounds good. We sound like we've probably got enough of the Grand Prix. We're willing to let you go on from here. Call that a Grand Prix.
Okay. Man, that was all four wheels off the ground there. Okay, max stop.
Okay, I don't want to do that.
Okay, excuse me.
They say that's a no-no.
The time had come to wrap up this EVA and get back inside the LEM. John and Charlie had been walking outside for 7 hours and 6 minutes. They doff their spacesuits, eat some dinner, and discuss their immediate impressions of the landing site with Mission Control. Prior to Apollo 16, there was heavy speculation that the valley between North Ray and South Ray had been subjected to relatively recent volcanism. After EVA 1, John and Charlie reported that based on the local crater density, the surface actually had to be much older. This was potentially grim news, especially considering that the site itself had been chosen specifically in order to find evidence of lunar volcanics. Geologists knew that the highlands were much older than the Mare, but they also hoped that one of the two Ray craters had managed to punch through this top layer of highland regolith into the bedrock below. Only visiting them would tell.
Hot dog, look at that beauty come out of there.
Ain't nothing, there's nothing plain about this place, Houston, I'll tell you. I don't know if ever thought it was plain.
Hey, fellas, we're able to see the Earth with your big eye there.
How about that? Pretty sight, isn't it?
Sure is. Yeah, it looks weird.
I tell you, Houston, my general impression of this thing is I'm a lot more surprised at how really beat up this place is. It must be the oldest stuff around because it just craters on top of craters on top of craters.
I mean, there's some really big old subdued craters that we don't even have mapped on our photo map, I'm sure of it.
Donnie, you ain't gonna believe it, but the food is blowing up like a balloon. You're kidding me.
No.
It popped out of that storage, left it to snap.
Now, we would also like to mention at this time that a decision has been reached not to attempt to repair the heat flow experiment, which was damaged on the first EVA. I repeat that, we have decided not to attempt to repair the heat flow experiment.
And your biomed looks great down here. Just keep up the orange juice, push on it a little bit there, and everything will be fine. Push on the orange juice and everything will be fine. Yeah, push on the orange juice, Rod. I'm gonna turn it to a citrus product is what I'm gonna do. Oh, well, that's good for you, John.
You ever heard of acid stomach, Tony?
Well, I don't know about that. Also, since tomorrow's pretty relaxed, we encourage you to get a lot of sleep tonight. You've got plenty of time. No need to feel like you got a press in the morning.
John and Charlie consume a meal of shrimp cocktail, turkey and gravy, chocolate pudding, and graham cracker cubes. They wash it down with orange juice. Lots and lots of orange juice.
I got the parts again. I got them again, Charlie. I don't know what the hell gives them to me. Certainly not. I think Dad didn't smell it. I really do. I haven't eaten this much citrus fruit in 20 years. I'll tell you one thing, in another 12 fucking days, I ain't never eating anymore. And if they offer to sub me potassium with my breakfast, I'm going to throw up. I like an occasional orange, really do. I'm going to be burying an orange. I put them up over the, right up in there. They ain't there? Oh, shit.
Orion, Houston.
Yes, sir.
Okay, John, you already have a hot mic.
Well, we had that. Well, unless it was a stuck mic button, that's the only thing we can think of because our configuration was normal. Sorry about that, but it's terrible being on a hot mic here sometimes.
Well, you guys have done commendably well considering the fact you didn't know you were on it. I'm very happy with your... We could say the same for some of the people down here.
This slip of the tongue, unfortunate as it is, nevertheless reflects a real frustration on the part of the crew. In order to better protect crews against the health issues like those faced by Jim Irwin on Apollo 15, the decision was made to buff the crew's diet with large amounts of potassium, largely in the form of potassium-spiked, powder-based drink mixes. The astronauts could have any flavor they wanted, so long as it was orange. The electrolyte-spiked orange juice was so bitter, even those who dared to try it in mission control often did not repeat their curiosity. A common misconception is that this drink mix is Tang. While Tang does share a close association with the American spaceflight program, it is a completely separate product from the dietary concoction prepared for the Apollo flights. According to the astronauts, even Tang is much more palatable. Finally, enough time had been spent on the moon that the first decisions were starting to be made regarding whether or not John and Charlie would be able to stay for the full 3 days. The data looked good. It was clear that the third moonwalk, EVA 3, would have to be shortened and several of its planned objectives canceled. Nevertheless, as the astronauts go to sleep for their second rest period on the lunar surface, they do so in high spirits. After so many close calls, the prospects of Apollo 16 meeting the vast majority of its primary scientific and operational objectives were looking better all the time. It wasn't an easy decision, however. Throughout Apollo 16's stay on the moon, there would be arguments among those in charge of mission planning and operations. Chris Kraft and others conservatively argue for an early liftoff in the name of safety and consumable margins. Gene Kranz and his ilk push back, explaining that an early liftoff would only put more pressure on the astronauts to try and meet all of their objectives in too short a time span. Eventually, Kranz won out. After 16 hours and 30 minutes inside the LEM, John and Charlie depressurized their spacecraft yet again, and at 142 hours and 39 minutes into the flight, the pair begin EVA-2. Today would be their first dedicated geologic traverse, traveling far to the south, assaulting the southwestern face of Stone Mountain to visit a series of craters called Cinco. Climbing higher above their LEM than any Apollo mission had previously, the pair are venturing even further towards the ejected blanket of South Ray Crater, away from the Cayley Plains and towards the Greater Descartes Formation, which geologists had hoped was volcanic in nature.
That's going to be a steep slope up there, John.
I believe it is, Charlie.
Up stone.
Yow! Woo! Man, that's a great big skid. We're doing 10 clicks, Tony.
Boy, it is something. It is really something.
You're still going 8 clicks, though, John. We're right on.
Hey, that was super. That wheel just left the ground.
It's the wildest ride I've ever on.
I love it. It's great. Tony, it doesn't feel like we're climbing, but we've been climbing for quite a while here. I just looked at the pitch meter, and it was pegged out a minute ago.
Wow.
Man, we are really going up a hill, I'll tell you. Yahoo! Boy!
And you left the ground again.
Houston, the best idea I can give you of what this looks like is it looks like about halfway up to that crater that we went to out at the Nevada test site. Man, I tell you, I've never seen so many blocks in my life. Boy, you just can't believe the blocks, Houston. The block population on survey, what is it, 50%?
Oh, I would say estimating 60 to 70.
Yeah.
Almost like a freshly plowed field that's been rained on.
Okay, you might look for a fresh crater that would punch through that ray material in the Descartes.
As the EVA progressed, the terrain continued to defy earthly expectations. As the astronauts near the top ridge of Stone Mountain, the layer of loose soil and regolith only got thicker. By the summit, they were sinking into the surface nearly 10 centimeters. Here they were, some 150 meters higher in elevation than where their LEM had landed. The pair were treated to an absolutely stunning view of the valley below them to the north.
And it's a beautiful sight.
Okay, we copy that, Josh.
Yeah, sure not. I mean, the material is not white. It's just the same as it,
rat. How'd you like that?
Beautiful maneuver there, Charlie.
The astronauts work their way back, stopping at various pre-planned sampling stations on the way. A crater called Wreck, another crater called Stubby. The astronauts were combing the northern face of Stone Mountain like forensic investigators, their eyes well-trained to hunt for rocks that were rounded, not angular, volcanic, not impact. Unfortunately for the scientists who eyed their progress back on Earth, all the training in the world could not produce what was not there. Nonetheless, the pair were still making incredible findings. Brown, rusty-colored rocks suggesting the presence of hydrated oxides of iron, perhaps even evidence of water on the moon. Evidence that would remain controversial for many decades, until modern unmanned exploration would show that the moon indeed has much higher concentrations of water ice than anyone had thought previously, especially at high latitudes.
This is going to be spectacular!
Yeah, we're getting up on a bench right now.
And boy, this is going to be such a spectacular view, you can't believe it.
And you're well ahead on the timeline. You've been making good time.
Crown Crater is about 60 feet above the planned stopping point.
Hey, fellas, Ken was just flying over and he saw a flash on the side of Descartes. He probably got a glint off you. Okay.
And we can see the whole lunar module. Look at that, John. Great, super. Wow, what a place. What a view, isn't it, John?
It's absolutely unreal.
We really come up here and Tony, it's just spectacular. I have never seen it. All I can say is spectacular, and I know y'all are sick of that word, but that, my vocabulary is so limited. Tony, you just can't believe this. There's this view. You can see the lunar module. You can see North Ray with boulders on the south, west side. And where Station 12 is, there's one huge boulder that's going to be just great.
Boy, is this a neat way to travel.
Isn't it great? I like to skip along.
Not me, boy.
Charlie, you're pure great.
Okay. Hey, John, it's easier to go straight across. That was fun.
Well, I haven't had any trouble.
Okay. I have a tough time walking up there.
During EVA 2, the right aft fender had fallen off the rover, causing the wheel to kick up lunar soil and spray it forward all over the astronauts when they were driving. As John operates the rover and Charlie navigates, the pair continually get dirtier. Their white spacesuits eventually transform into a dark, dusty gray.
Look at this baby. I'm really getting confidence in it now. It's really humming like a kitten.
Oh, this machine is super.
Yeah. Boy, Charlie, look at this rock. That is a crystalline rock. We're going to get that one. That's the first one I've seen here that I really believe is a crystalline rock. You
want to put it in the padded bag?
Outstanding.
Okay, we have to break it in two.
No, we don't need that in the padded bag.
Young and Duke will now bypass Station 7 and continue on to Station 8.
Sorry,
we're out there an hour. We're out here an hour. Tony, we've been here an hour?
Yes, you have.
It doesn't seem like it.
I'm flying, huh?
Sure does.
Dang, that rock over there is the one I want to sneak up on, Charlie.
Yeah,
but don't open that. It's between us and the limb. It's between the limb and us.
Oh, I know that, but they don't want you to open that thing until you get right up next to the rock.
Gee, we're missing the great rock hunt here.
You're just not watching him sneak, Tony.
Well, I'd sure like to.
Gotcha. What are y'all doing looking at the seats?
Which way do we go?
We're sneaking up on it, Tony. Got him.
Don't scare it.
Okay.
And we encourage you
just
to look
down
there,
John, but that's quite a ways down. That fender was well needed, John. I'm being showered with
dust. I didn't mean to do that, so am I.
Man, you have cooked. I am covered from head to foot with dust. Boy, those fenders really are useful, Tony. This one we lost in the back has resulted in us being
pretty dirty.
Double thick bin.
You're gonna have to really brush.
Charlie, you mean you guys are getting dirty?
Maybe that's how we get our extension.
It's sitting in the heat flow. See how far you can throw that beauty. Look at that. Being across the crater. Beautiful.
Why don't you just give us an extension?
Tony, how about an extension, you guys? We're feeling good.
Well, we understand, and we can understand why you wouldn't want to get back in, but we'd like you to get back in on time, and you've got a lot of science there, so don't worry about it.
Is that all we're going to do tonight? We'll sit around and talk.
We'd like to hear you talk.
Tony, we could really,
especially on hot mics.
That just makes it more interesting.
10 minutes, we get all this done, Tony. Man, we got a lot of rocks.
Good show.
Only way to
the name of the game.
Yeah, we got 2 hours, and I got the feeling we're going to spend up the night bleeding each other off. Gas knocking it off.
Now, wait now, don't hit. No, Charlie. I wouldn't hit you hard.
Listen, nobody's ever tried that on a pressure.
Haley came loose here.
He's just knocking me in the head, Houston, in case you're wondering what's going on.
Got it off, though. You gotta admit.
Get the dirt off.
After 7.5 hours, their longest moonwalk yet, the pair once again head back inside Orion. According to John Young, the hardest task of the entire mission was always re-entering the lunar module at the end of an EVA. One major issue faced was contamination by moon dust. The lunar regolith is so fine and so very slightly magnetic that it clings to just about everything. By the time John and Charlie had taken off their filthy spacesuits, they had generated a cloud of moon dust inside the LEM, which they were breathing in. This dust then settles on just about every surface inside the spacecraft, getting inside switches and joints, just about any cavity one could imagine. It accumulates onto Velcro, making it less effective. It penetrates the fastening rings of the spacesuit's helmet and gloves, making them harder to tighten. The pair do the best they can with a wet rag, but the dust is relentless. One spacecraft and astronaut who is free from the horrors of lunar dust, at least for now, is Casper and its sole occupant, Ken Mattingly. As John and Charlie explore the surface, Ken continues to operate the scientific experiments of the sim bay and map the lunar surface under his orbital ground track. In a very real sense, Mattingly gets to see much more of the moon than John and Charlie do, though his exploration is not nearly as intimate. Ken encounters some minor difficulty in retracting some of the booms on which instrumentation is mounted, but otherwise, things are progressing exactly as planned. Apollo 16 takes more photographs and film of the moon than any previous Apollo flight. Ken Mattingly also observes flashes of light on the night side of the lunar surface. He is likely witnessing meteoroid impacts, which occur at incredible velocities. Mattingly makes more comprehensive deep space measurements and observations than any of his predecessors, and his careful stewardship over the delicate and complex instruments in the sim bay adds to the growing score of knowledge and insight into the unique environment of the moon. Ken becomes a member of a club even smaller than those who have walked on the moon, the few astronauts who have been alone in lunar orbit. The sole master of his spacecraft and home, able to more deeply reflect on the beauty of it all. But he is by no means lonely. Mission Control and the Orbital Science Team ensure that Ken has plenty to do during his 3 days of orbital coast.
Ken Mattingly aboard the orbiting CSM. Casper is preparing to do a plane change maneuver to put the spacecraft in the proper position for rendezvous and docking later with the lunar module. The maneuver will be performed with the service propulsion system engine, changing the velocity 124.7 feet per second, and it will be a 7-second burn.
165 hours, 31 minutes, 28 seconds. John and Charlie begin EVA 3. Today is the day that had been in doubt since the lunar landing. The plan is heavily modified and deviates significantly from its original form. Several geology stops are cut out entirely, and there would be no rest period after this EVA. John and Charlie will head north, visit the rim of North Ray Crater, spending just about 5 hours outside, and immediately head back in the LEM and ascend from the lunar surface, making a rendezvous and docking with Ken inside Casper.
When Young and Duke step onto the lunar surface, this third EVA, the predicted temperature in the sun on the surface will be about 185 degrees. That's risen from about 90 degrees Fahrenheit that we saw during the first EVA as the sun elevation continues to climb.
Audio U.S. flag. Looks colorful. Okay. Okay, Tony, it looks like we're about 10 minutes ahead and we're ready to move out.
Okay, good show. You fellas are really getting smooth.
The abundance of breccias or fragmental rocks discovered on the first two EVAs leads to the possibility that much of the rock below the regolith consists of very old breccias dating back to perhaps 3.5 billion years. North Ray is deeper than South Ray, which was visited yesterday, and may possibly penetrate this layer of breccias or fragmental rocks and get down to the volcanic material that's believed to underlie the area, and which may date back to 4 billion years. Hopefully the crew will be able to get some of this very old crystalline rock by visiting the vicinity of North Ray Crater.
As the pair drive north, past Palmetto Crater and towards North Ray, the boulders gradually become larger and more abundant. North Ray would be, and still is, the largest crater ever visited by humans on the moon. Nearly 1 kilometer wide and 230 meters, or 750 feet deep, just over twice the size of the gigantic Saturn V moon rocket that made this mission possible.
I think we're coming up on the rim now, John.
All right, Charlie.
There it is.
There it is. Beautiful.
Look at that view.
Look at those boulders.
Look at those rocks. And there's the beauty of those white rocks are...
Right on the rim.
Right on the rim.
Outstanding.
Oh, spectacular. Just spectacular.
Man, does this thing have steep walls.
They said 60 degrees.
Now, I tell you, I can't see to the bottom of it, and I'm as close to the edge as I'm going to get.
Now, the layer, the boulder layers are horizontally oriented, and of course, they're all covered with talus. Over on the north wall in particular, about one-third of the way from the top is a line of boulders that you probably ought to be able to see on the TV, but they're all oriented right in that line.
Man, I wish I could see the bottom of this beauty.
I'd like to make sure that we're not overlooking something here, Charlie.
That's why I'd like to go on down to that black rock down there, John.
You really got your eye on, I can tell.
Big one.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, the regolith here, Tony, up on this crater rim is really soft. We're sinking in on these slopes about 6 inches or so.
The pair parked their rover at Station 11, right on the rim, and begin working against the clock to sample the rim of the crater and the lower slopes of a hill called Smoky Mountain. While it had been originally believed that North Ray punched through Cayley-like material, John and Charlie observe high amounts of light matrix breccias, which is more indicative of Descartes-like material. It was an incredibly impressive sight, but still no definitive sign of volcanism. The astronauts see what looks like a pretty sizable boulder in the distance and venture forth on foot to give it a visit.
How's our time going, Tony?
You're doing really fine. We've got an extension here and you got about 25 minutes.
Look at the size of that biggie. It is a biggie, isn't it?
It may be further away than we think.
No, it's not very far. It was just right beyond you. The old footprints on a crater rim.
If we could see to the bottom, we could say for sure if this big black rock is right out of the bottom. But my guess from the old photographs is it probably is.
Okay, that sounds like a good guess.
Look, see this rock right here, Charlie?
Look at the size of that rock.
And as our crew slowly sinks, we bet a pond disappeared into the sunset.
God, you think they weren't at it?
It looked like they were standing right there.
Curious what they're going to look like when they stand next to it.
Once I get to it, the bigger it is.
Yeah, but look at the permanent shadows part, Charlie.
On this side over here?
Yeah. And look at those. Look at the shape of that rock.
Well, Tony, that's your half rock right there.
Very good. Don't get too near the edge of that thing. It falls off. Look over at your right. It falls off pretty good.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, keep going!
Jack, that's a good point to remember. All three crews now tend to think they're there before they get there.
I remember.
Well, I think we can get it permanently shattered under that big rock. Look at that fillet on this side, Charlie.
Okay, well, we need to shovel for that.
Hey, Tony, my guess is that most of these rocks around here are extremely shocked. And it looks, it's got a bluish tint to it, doesn't it?
Does. Look at that shatter cone right there, Charlie. I'll be darned.
It is.
Yeah. Sure.
Right there.
Outstanding.
Yeah. Look at that veinlet running through right there, John, of a breccia. And it's a big rock. Wow.
That big black dot. Fantastic. Like right here.
Okay, that's fine. That's all I need.
That's all Tony needs. Do PI on this one, Tony?
No, I said that's all they need.
From the rover, no one could have guessed how humongous this boulder really was. But the closer John and Charlie got, the more impressive it became. House Rock is a four-story behemoth, likely excavated from the massive impact that formed North Ray. Samples from this massive boulder deliver the final blow to the pre-mission volcanic hypothesis about the landing site, proving it incorrect. House Rock was perforated with micrometeorite impact holes.
Can we put those two rock bags under your seat, Tony? You got too much stuff in there now.
Brad, what'd you say, Ralph?
I said, sure. Put those two rock bags under your seat.
Okay, in the left. Okay, Tony, in the left setting, going from right to left.
Sorry, John, didn't see it.
After an hour and a half, the pair move on, stopping half a kilometer to the south by a rock nicknamed Shadow, where the pair are able to reach under and sample permanently shadowed soil. John continues to operate the lunar portable magnetometer and makes the strongest localized magnetic field readings of any moon mission, over 10 times stronger than what had been expected.
So far on this trip, my personal estimation of Charlie's slope estimates is you can take him and double every one of them. That was always my problem. But good.
My 10% never added up to 100, John.
Yeah, but you're not exaggerating here, I'll tell you that. You're sure under-exaggerating. Houston, this is the roughest terrain to beat planes I ever saw.
Oh, boy, Tony. This has been a good traverse up here.
It sure looks good down here, I tell you.
Some spectacular scenery.
I'm sure glad we got this EVA-3.
We picked up the right rocks. I think they're two predominant types. Yeah, me too.
Hey, incidentally, we reduced the magnetometer reading now, and it's 313 gammas down, which is by far the strongest reading we've seen on the moon. It's about 100 more than they got on Apollo 14.
Well, the magnetic field of the moon in places is a lot more than anybody ever believed it would be.
That's right. From lunar orbit, it only looks like, from high lunar orbit, it only looks like 2 or 3 gamma at most.
Sun's up over Stone. Can't believe it.
No, the sun is so high.
And Charlie, you might look around.
I was looking right at that big rock. What do you think of that beauty?
That's exactly what we're looking at. While John's doing the LPM, we'd like you to hammer on that rock a bit.
Yes, sir, baby. That is a perfect shattered soil sample.
Outstanding.
Oh, that there is one of those gopher holes.
Yeah.
Hey, John, you think
perfect
you can push that one over?
You do that in West Texas and you get a rattlesnake. John's got a long way to go, Tony, before he gets that thing reeled in.
Charlie. Thanks for those words of encouragement.
We had these white suits on when we started, but the moon dust is very, very fine, like powder. And so as you walk, you kick it up, and you got a shovel, and you're shoveling rocks into these bags. and this dust gets all over you. And one reason it got really on us was because we lost our fender on the rover, and as we drove across the moon, this moon dust rained down on top of us. It was very, very fine and gray, so your suit began to turn gray. And at the end of our stay, you couldn't hardly tell it was a white suit. It was mostly gray. And we tracked a lot of the dust back in on our moon boots and on the suits, and that just lay on the floor. But when we got back in orbit, all that dust came up and was floating around. It was really a problem.
Look at that, Charlie. Clean across the crater. It goes the javelin throw.
Wow.
Won't win any world record, but... Okay.
John and I decided we were the... only flight, well, not the only flight, but the flight before the 72 Olympics were in Munich, Germany. So we were going to do the Moon Olympics, and we were going to do the high jump record. I was going to do that, and John was going to do the long jump. And that was the two events we were going to have on the Moon Olympics. And though we didn't tell anybody about this. And, you know, Apollo 15, they had the hammer and feather. Apollo 14, Alan Shepard hit the golf ball. And so it just sort of wind down our 3 days on the moon, we were going to do the Olympics. So, but we were running behind, and Mission Control was bugging us, get in, it's time to go. Close up, you know, park the rover, let's go. And so John starts bouncing. He said, well, we were going to do the Moon Olympics, Houston, but we're behind. And so John starts bouncing, and so I start bouncing. I gave a big bounce for the record, if you will, and when I did, I straightened up. Well, the backpack weighed 150 pounds, and I weigh 150 pounds, so the CG went backwards, and there I go, over backwards.
We were going to do a bunch of exercises that we had made up as the Lunar Olympics. Show you what a guy could do on the moon with a backpack on. But... About 380 pound guy, that's pretty good. They threw that out. Yeah, jumped flat footed straight in the air. 300, about 4 feet. Wow. Charlie, that ain't any fun, is it?
That ain't very
smart. Well, sorry about that.
Right, now we do have some work to do.
How about a hand, John? There we go. Okay, man, Tony, you don't know how much fun this has been. I can tell, Charlie. Yeah, I think it's been obvious in your voice how much fun it's been. And Houston, this portable life support system is really a good piece of gear,
and we better hustle on back in. We're getting up against the time limit. We'd like you to get on in.
Home again, jiggity jig. Home again.
This is Apollo Control. Young and Duke have now been on the lunar surface for approximately 5 hours. This EVA is now 5 hours, 4 minutes long since they depressurized the lunar module. And Flight Director Pete Frank says we hope to have them back in the lunar module and pressurized within about 20 minutes.
Tony, a special salute to me, from me to the United States Air Force on their silver anniversary this year. From one of the boys in blue, is pretty far out right now.
You betcha, sir. That's outstanding.
Boy, Houston, the beauty of this place is absolutely incredible. Okay, Tony, I'm inside.
Good show.
The pair parked their rover 100 meters east of Orion at the so-called VIP site, the rover's final resting place. They leave it behind and advance to the LEM on foot, now entering the final precious minutes of their time walking on the moon. John and Charlie leave the surface for the final time. The mission of Apollo 16 thus far had triumphed. Triumphed in the face of adversity at nearly every stage of the flight. the benefit of the experience of prior lunar missions, and the incredible training received by the crew. NASA had proven yet again that Apollo was a well-oiled machine. In their three moonwalks, they had spent a combined 20 hours and 12 minutes outside, and collected some 94 kilograms, or 207 pounds of surface samples. The apparent lack of volcanism at their site was a disappointment to the scientists and forced a re-examination of how landing sites were studied and interpreted from orbital photographs. Nonetheless, the crew of Apollo 16 met the mark of excellence yet again.
Smile, FAO. Don't be mad. We'll get it up there. See how nice and leisurely it's been? That's the way it should be, getting ready for ascent.
4.5 hours after re-entering the lunar module, the two astronauts begin the long journey homeward.
Over. Midover's on time.
Roger, we saw lift off.
What a ride.
All right, you go at one.
Roger, looking good here.
For the first time, the ascent engine starts a few milliseconds too early, before the pyrotechnic charges that cut it free of the descent stage had fired. As a result, a pressure wave forms in the space between the two stages, which escapes out the back and absolutely shreds the micrometeorite shielding panels located there. Though the damage is entirely cosmetic and not structural in any way, as Orion nears Casper in lunar orbit just 2 hours after ascent, Ken Mattingly is astonished to see just how torn up the aft section of the ascent stage really is. It was a one-orbit rendezvous, complete with automatic radar tracking and all four guidance computers working in perfect conjunction. It was flawless.
Okay, Casper, we have you visually.
Glad to hear it. I don't have you yet.
Well, Jim, the sunset is spectacular.
I bet it is.
Man, that I could see that thing, light of yours at 70 miles in the telescope, even.
Okay, Jim, we're 3 miles out, closing. Guess we don't need to tell you, but this is a sweet machine.
You're so right.
A little tiny black dot to the naked eye. I can't tell about the bottom. On the backside, the mylar blankets are still intact. It's only that outer covering that's broken. Okay, you have station keeping and I'm maneuvering. The things I'd like for you to look at are, you remember on the aft shelf of the sim bay, there's two booms back there. The one of my, the most plus Y one is the mass spec. It's got a white cover. And it's kind of a rectangular shaped cover. The one on the left, or it's really in about the center of the sim bay, is the aft end, and it has a silver cover, and that's the gamma ray. Would you take a look and see if either of the covers are not quite closed, because we have indications in the spacecraft that they're not closed and indications on the ground that they are.
Are you maneuvering, Kim?
Yes, sir. This is one of the fastest maneuvers I've made in a long time. Okay, I'm approaching. Your attitude looks good. I'll tell you when we have captured. Okay, about 5 feet. Okay, it looks pretty fair. How about if I just retract you? Doesn't look like it. I don't have any barber poles. There we go. Took a couple extra lurps to get you.
Casper's captured Orion.
Very good. We were wondering what took you so long.
We're doing these fancy maneuvers up here. Hardly anybody ever gets to do a 360-degree yaw on the moon.
Reunited at last, the three astronauts transfer the samples and science experiments from the LEM into the command module, and after a short rest period, jettison Orion just 12 seconds after the 195-hour mark in their flight. April 24th, 1972. Shortly after jettisoning the LEM, it develops a slight tumble of 3 degrees per second. This was not planned, and likely the result of a guidance circuit breaker being left open. Unfortunately, this meant the lunar module would not be able to be remotely commanded to make an automatic retrofire. It would have to be left in lunar orbit, its trajectory slowly being warped by mass cons below until it eventually impacted the moon a year later, the event recorded by the still-functioning ALSEP seismometers. During the 62nd lunar revolution, Casper deploys its small sub-satellite, which will be left in lunar orbit to measure plasma and energetic particle fluxes. As a result of the earlier CSM engine gimbal troubles, a planned orbital shaping burn was not conducted, and the satellite was thus inserted into a less than nominal orbit. It is believed that the satellite struck the far side of the moon, not too far after lunar module Orion did, in May of 1973. Because there were still concerns regarding the SPS engine, a decision was made to bring Apollo 16 home a day early, and at 200 hours and 21 minutes into the flight, the fuel valves snap open, and Casper's engine begins pushing her out of lunar orbit.
16, you're go for TEI.
16 is going for TEI.
Roger.
Trans-Earth injection was achieved at a velocity of 2,600 meters per second after 64 lunar orbits, lasting a total of 125 hours, 49 minutes, and 32 seconds. Apollo 16 was coming home.
Roger. Just saw you come up like thunder, and that's how we're coming up. Just going away from it, Mike. Nothing. This moon is really, really a fascinating satellite. Boy, there's something new and different, and you can sure see a lot of variety with you right here. I think the general agreement in the cockpit is that morale around here just went up a couple 100%.
Really spectacular view. Really good performance here.
Tell us about it.
Yeah, the old crescent Earth coming up there. The Earth rise was just beautiful. It just came up like gangbusters. We were looking right out the window, and there you came, and right now you're almost a crescent Earth, just a very sliver out there.
Shortly after TEI, NASA makes the final television transmissions of the lunar surface from the rover's camera, which was still functioning some 30 hours after EVA-3. The astronauts make their final observations of the moon as Casper begins the 3-day freefall back to Earth.
Is the LCRU still working?
It was last night, they say.
I'll be darned.
Houston, another great view that we had right before TEI was your Tom Merced. Your crescent was the lit light portion of the Earth was tangent to the lunar horizon. And as you went down, you ended up looking like a big moon horns up there. Houston, we now have looking out the center hatch window, fills the whole window. I can see from horizon to horizon by just being about 4 inches from the center hatch window. What a spectacular view.
Roger.
Hey, that's really great.
Man, a beautiful picture, Charlie.
I tell you, yeah, and it's just about that big, too, from where we're looking. It just fills the window just about like that. Yeah, we refuse to show you the pressure suits. Y'all get tired of looking, you just cut off the lines or go to command reset or something.
Roger.
This is what the well-dressed LFP on Apollo 16 has been wearing for the last, whatever. All the way out and all the way back. Well,
Well, I can hardly believe the last 3 days, Pete. That was, the Kelly Plains was really the most fascinating place I've ever been in my life, and we'll never hope to go. And we sure had a good time collecting all the rocks.
You talk about it. You talk about two dirty human beings. It took 10 minutes before we could get Ken to open the door. As soon as he saw us, he wanted to close it.
Question number one for John Young. A couple of times you were on hot mic and didn't know it. But how could a nice Florida boy like you say what you did about citrus fruit?
Okay. That's great.
That's a very good question. Wait till you drink it day and night for 2 weeks.
What do you hope to tell your grandchildren as your most memorable moment of your trip to the moon?
Well, I'll start with that one, Hank. I have two impressions. The first is the dazzling beauty of the cart, the surface. It was just one of the most awe-inspiring sights I've ever seen. And secondly, on the EVA, when you look away from the Earth or the Moon, it's just the utter blackness of space. It really is black out there.
I thought I knew someone would ask that question, and I've been asking that question too. And I don't think I can put an impression. There's so many that we've crammed in the last 12 days. It seems like each one comes on top of the other one, and the immediate response that you come up with is, that's the most fantastic thing I've ever seen. And in a lot of respects, it really is. There have been so many events and so many sights that in my case, I'm going to have to sit and think about this one for a long time before I could ever pick out one. And I'm not sure I'll ever be able to say that there was a unique thing or a most memorable event. The whole thing has been just one series of very impressive and, I hate to use the word, but I don't know anything else except to say it's fantastic. I think Ken's got the answer. I think we've seen as much in 10 days as most people see in 10 lifetimes.
For each of you, based on your experience, do you have any recommendations right now for the crew of Apollo 17?
Yeah, I recommend they enjoy it as much as we did. I'm sure they will.
At 218 hours, the highlight of the mission for Ken Mattingly began, as he had to make an extravehicular activity of his own. Charlie Duke stands in the hatch and supports Ken as he ventures outside. He also operates a couple handheld experiments. Ken spends a total of 1 hour and 22 minutes outside the spacecraft, one of only 3 people to have made a spacewalk in cislunar space, the other two being the command module pilots of the other J missions, Apollo 15 and Apollo 17.
Okay. Houston, are you getting a picture?
That's affirmative.
Oh, just me. I gotta get my umbilical up here first up. Jake?
Charlie, can you verify the TV poles aligned?
Number one, I'm at the mapping camera, and the stellar cover door is open, and the stellar cover is jammed out, and it's jammed against the handrail. Oh, man. Man, the old moon's out there. Okay, going after the pan camera. Well, that old visor of yours, that outer visor with the glare seal, really comes in handy. Okay, first thing that's real obvious to you out here is the amount of bubbling on the service module paint. It's a bit more than I anticipated seeing. And the radiator panel down to the right side of the assembly, it looks nice and clean. There's no bubbles on the paint or anything like that.
Apollo 16 makes 2 slight mid-course correction burns on the way home, and the crew conducts their final television broadcast on April 26. The command module separates from the service module at 265 hours and 22 minutes into flight, and entry into the Earth's atmosphere begins just 15 minutes later.
Mr. Descartes said it. He said, there's nothing so far removed from us as to be beyond our reach, or so hidden that we cannot discover it. And you'll know Descartes was a French mathematician and philosopher for whom the region was named. And I guess really the story of our mission so far is we've been out testing this theory. My personal assessment of where we are right now is as we get the rocks back in the LRL, we'll be making headway toward proving he was right.
Velocity 36,094 feet per second, range to go 1,357 nautical miles. Minus 10 seconds, velocity 36,173 feet per second, range to go 1,270 nautical miles. We've seen a dropout in our telemetry data indicating Apollo 16 now passing through the Earth's atmosphere.
And it's been 50 years now, well, about 10 years ago, NASA, it was under President Bush, he announced the a program that was a return to the moon, the Constellation program. But Obama canceled most of it, but still left the command module part alive. But the lander was canceled. So now we have, right now we've been working on this spacecraft called, and now the name is Orion. And it's deep space and will take us to the moon and to an asteroid. And I think NASA's going to be focused on that, and over, and we can get there in that in 5 years, easy.
After a deceleration which brings nearly 8 G's onto the crew, Casper belly flops onto the surface of the Pacific Ocean, flipping over and entering the stable 2 position in the water. Just 37 minutes after splashdown, the crew are delivered to the deck of the USS Ticonderoga.
Overall in Apollo, I think probably the biggest mistake we made was on the lunar surface not taking more pictures with people in them. A lot of rocks, we got a lot of rocks, but not too many good pictures with people.
Well, that's our job, was to take pictures of rocks. They didn't want pictures with people in them. Now, they wanted pictures of people near the rocks so they could tell where the rocks were, but if you got their feet or their arms or their legs, that was okay. But, I mean, we had to take 5 pictures per rock.
I look back on our mission, and I think that's probably not. Why didn't we get more pictures of John?
I think we're mighty lucky to have pictures of us saluting the flag.
This is Apollo Control, Houston. We copied time of splashdown as 290 hours, 37 minutes, 6 seconds, ground elapsed time.
Recovery, this is Ticonderoga. You are cleared to deploy. Our recovery, right here.
Beautiful.
There they are.
Control Houston, an observer on the Ticonderoga estimates a distance of...
Just got it on in time.
It goes without saying that the 6 Apollo moon landings are a national, political, and technological feat that remain unparalleled in contemporary history. The large majority of the financial cost of Apollo was incurred before any of the flights had actually taken place, simply to research and develop the technology required to make it possible. By 1970, costs had come down significantly, but the political toll had extracted a price of its own. For those involved, Apollo ended far too soon, and with too small a scientific return on the massive investment made. Many saw Apollo as the final appendage of the heady political legacy of John Kennedy. It was also, however, a political triumph for his successor, Lyndon Baines Johnson, after whom the Space Center in Houston is named. As the 1960s turned into the 1970s, what started as a heady and ambitious decade brought instead political assassinations, societal turmoil, and the Vietnam War. All of which, including Apollo and the Great Society welfare programs, became associated with President Johnson. By 1972, 4 years into Nixon's presidency, this was starting to turn into a political liability. Adding insult to injury, hardware for Apollo 18 and 19 had been fully built, and these missions could have flown at a trivial extra cost. Instead, these two magnificent launch vehicles now serve as gigantic museum pieces at NASA space centers. NASA continues to struggle, to this day, to stay insulated from American politics. Presidential administrations set NASA's agenda. When the political situation changes and a new administration comes into power, they often cancel or significantly alter the plans set by their predecessors. Since space exploration programs often take much longer to realize than a period of 4 or 8 years, the only thing this accomplishes is a massive and constant flux of manpower, money, and effort, with nothing significant being achieved. 50 years on from Apollo, we have lost a significant amount of the living memory and technological expertise built up from the first lunar program. Nonetheless, Apollo made incredible contributions to the technological and engineering feats that would work their way into civilian life into the following decades. Zero-fault engineering, freeze-dried food, cooling suits, a whole new slew of fireproof materials, digital fly-by-wire, digital image processing, foundations which led to the development of the MRI machine, integrated circuits, hard disk drive storage, air purification, anti-icing chemicals, digital cameras, memory foam, scratch-resistant lenses, and power tools. Just a few of the things that have vastly improved modern quality of life, all of which were accelerated into existence by Apollo. From a scientific standpoint, Apollo also helped solve some of the fundamental mysteries regarding our neighbor and satellite, the Moon. We know now that the Moon is an evolved terrestrial body with internal zoning and structure, that it is ancient and preserves an early history of the Earth-Moon system, that the youngest moon rocks are as old as the oldest Earth rocks, that the Moon and Earth, while geologically related, were formed from different proportions of a common set of geologic materials, that the Moon is slightly asymmetrical, with a thicker crust on the far side and volcanic basins on the near side, that the entire surface is covered in a thin layer of dust called regolith that preserves a unique record of solar radiation, and, most importantly of all, that the Moon likely formed as a result of a collision between a primordial Earth, nicknamed Gaia, and a Mars-sized planetoid nicknamed Theia. The impact and accretion of the Gaia-Theia collision formed the modern Earth-Moon system that we have today. With the chapter of Apollo 16 now closed, the countdown begins for the 20th century's final human adventure into the solar system. One final landing on the Moon. A mission that would come to encapsulate everything Apollo represented. A last giant leap for mankind.